Hello everyone, I'm Dr. Prashant, and in this presentation we will talk about renal replacement therapy. Renal replacement therapy are a set of techniques and interventions which is meant to replace the filtering function of the kidney. These include dialysis and renal transplant. In this presentation, we will be talking about the various modalities of dialysis. One of the most important concepts is the indications of urgent dialysis. To remember the urgent indications is as easy as knowing the vowels in the English alphabet. A stands for acidosis, E stands for electrolyte abnormalities such as hyperkalemia and hypercalcemia, I stands for intoxication with methanol, barbiturates, etc. O stands for fluid overload, and U stands for uremic encephalopathy and uremic pericarditis. The choice of dialysis modality depends upon hemodynamic stability. In patients who are hemodynamically stable, we can consider intermittent hemodialysis, and in patients who are hemodynamically unstable, we can consider continuous renal replacement therapy. The modalities may also be classified into whether the requirement for dialysis is acute, in which case we have intermittent hemodialysis, continuous renal replacement therapy, peritoneal dialysis, and hybrid therapies. For chronic dialysis, such as in patients with chronic kidney disease, we have intermittent hemodialysis and peritoneal dialysis. Hemodialysis is the diffusion of solutes across a semipermeable membrane and across an electrochemical gradient. This is a schematic diagram of the dialysis circuit. This is the arterial end and this is the venous end. The venous end is interrupted by this yellow colored circuit, which is the dialysis circuit. This is where the dialysate is poured into, and this is where the dialysate drains out. When the dialysis starts, arterial blood flows in this direction and the venous blood flows in this direction. The dialysate flows in the opposite direction, thereby causing convective and diffusive clearance of solutes and urea, along with application of a particular amount of pressure. The goal of dialysis is to restore an intracellular and extracellular environment similar to the normal functioning of the kidney. The transport of solute such as urea into the dialysate and transport of bicarbonate into the blood from the dialysate is also undertaken. The key components of the dialysis prescription are as follows. Dialyzers are generally of hollow fiber configuration and are used because of improved safety. Membrane biomaterials being used recently include synthetic membranes, which have now almost completely replaced cellulose membranes. When it comes to membrane permeability, high flux membranes are now preferred. The duration of dialysis is generally 4 hours, and solute removal is not significantly increased with longer duration. However, longer duration of dialysis does increase the incidence of intradialytic hypotension. Dialysis is generally given 3 times a week, and more frequent treatment improves solute and fluid clearance. However, data from large randomized controlled trials in this regard are awaited. The flow rates in dialysis include the blood flow rate, which is typically at 200 to 400 milliliters per minute. The dialysis flow rate is optimized for near maximal solute clearance, and the ultrafiltration rate is usually less than 10 milliliter per kg per hour to avoid intradialytic hypotension. The medications which may be given during intermittent hemodialysis include erythropoietin, iron, vitamin analogs, antibiotics, and heparin. The access to hemodialysis include fistula, graft or catheter through which blood is obtained for hemodialysis, the Brescia Chimeno fistula, which is a fistula between the cephalic vein and the radial artery, is used most commonly. At present, placement of an arteriovenous graft, which is made of polytetrafluoroethylene, is preferred, and this is part of the fistula first initiative. Tunneled catheters may also be used. Thrombosis of graft remains an important complication of hemodialysis access procedures. The calculation of efficiency of dialysis is based on the urea kinetic modeling. Urea is neither highly protein bound nor lipophilic. As a result, it predicts morbidity and mortality, and amount of urea to be removed can be calculated. The first technique used is urea reduction ratio. The second technique is KT by V. In this formula, K is the urea clearance of the dialyzer, T is the duration of dialysis, and V is the patient's volume of urea distribution. KT by V is generally 1.4 for intermittent hemodialysis and at lower values for other modalities of dialysis. Beta 2 microglobulin is easy to measure and is used as a marker for middle molecular weight solutes, and high flux hemodialysis membranes may reduce mortality. The clinical care of patients with dialysis includes dialysis dose, as already described, is at 1.4 or higher. Fluid management and body weight may be done by monitoring intradialytic weight gain, and this should be less than 5% of total body weight. The dialysate quality should be monitored for contamination with endotoxin and bacteria. Patients with chronic kidney disease are targeted to have a hemoglobin of 10 grams per deciliter. Continuing on with clinical care of patients with dialysis, strategies for placement and use of fistulas over catheters should be preferred. Bone and mineral disorders should be tackled by targeting a calcium of 8.4 to 9.5 milligrams per deciliter and a phosphate of 3.5 to 5.5 milligrams per deciliter. We must suppress PTH with vitamin D analogs and calcimimetic agents. We must focus also on nutrition with a target albumin of 4 grams per deciliter and must consider enteral supplementation in patients with signs of protein wasting. Blood pressure must be maintained according to existing guidelines, and we prefer a blood pressure target of 130 by 80 in patients with chronic kidney disease. We must target an LDL cholesterol of less than 100 milligrams per deciliter. Diabetes must be managed according to existing standard of care, and transplantation referral must be undertaken early. The quality of life and psychosocial evaluation may be done according to the Kidney Disease Quality of Life Instrument, or KDQOL-36, to assess the quality of life. The complications of dialysis include hypotension, and this is due to excessive ultrafiltration, impaired vasoactive or autonomic responses, and reduced cardiac reserve. Administration of 100 to 250 ml of isotonic saline or 10 ml of 23% saturated saline may be undertaken. The other complication include muscle cramps, which is present in more than half of the patients, and anaphylactide reactions, which include type A reactions or type B. Type A is IgE-mediated hypersensitivity reaction, whereas type B is complement and cytokine-mediated. These generally resolve over time with continuing dialysis. The next modality is peritoneal dialysis, which may be either continuous ambulatory peritoneal dialysis or CAPD, in which manual infusion is undertaken, or it may be continuous cycling peritoneal dialysis, in which the dialysate is infused automatically. In peritoneal dialysis, 1.5 to 3 liters of dextrose-containing solution is infused into the peritoneal cavity and allowed to dwell for 2 to 4 hours. Convective and diffusive clearance account for clearance of solutes along with fluid hypertonicity. The rate of clearance usually decreases with time until a steady state is achieved. In peritoneal dialysis, dextrose is usually administered to provide hypertonicity. However, recently the use of icodextrin is found to be more efficient at ultrafiltration and is given at the last longest dwell of the day. The concept of peritoneal dialysis can be demonstrated in this schematic diagram. The layers are the blood vessel, lymphatics, peritoneal membrane, and the peritoneal cavity. The fluid is now infused into the peritoneal cavity during peritoneal dialysis, and this is the creatinine in the blood, which now diffuses to the peritoneal fluid. The complications of peritoneal dialysis include peritonitis, which is defined as more than 100 neutrophils per microliter in the peritoneal dialysis fluid. The patient may have pain and there might be a cloudy dialysate. Generally, Staphylococcus aureus, gram-negative rods, fungal and mycobacterial infections are possible, and administration of appropriate antimicrobial therapy is the hallmark of care. The patient may also have catheter-associated non-peritonitis infections and metabolic disturbances such as hypoproteinemia, hyperglycemia. Hypoproteinemia is due to albumin loss along with metabolic waste, and hyperglycemia is due to dextrose-containing dialysate. We now move on to continuous renal replacement therapy. This is a schematic diagram of the CRRT circuit. The main thing to note here is the presence of a hemofilter which functions during the dialysis process. The vascular access for CRRT is undertaken at a rate of 200 to 250 ml per minute, and double lumen jugular catheter is preferred. CRRT may be preferred for patients with acute kidney injury and with raised ICT. This is because intermittent hemodialysis may worsen cerebral edema by causing reducing mean arterial pressure and causing cerebral vasodilatation. Intermittent hemodialysis may also worsen patients with increased intracranial tension due to rapid removal of urea, which shifts the fluid into the interstitial space. The general concept is that continuous renal replacement therapy is used for hemodynamically unstable patients. There are a few types of CRRT which we will introduce here. These include continuous veno-venous hemofiltration, continuous veno-venous hemodialysis, continuous veno-venous hemodiafiltration, and slow continuous ultrafiltration. The long-term outcomes in end-stage renal disease are associated with increased rate of complications, such as increased incidence of infection, progressive debility and frailty in the elderly, protein energy malnutrition, and impaired cognitive function. Also, there is increased cardiovascular mortality in patients with end-stage renal disease, and this is because of etiological factors such as uremia toxin accumulation, altered intermediary metabolism, and hormone deficiency. The mediators of such increased cardiovascular mortality include sympathetic overactivity, oxidative stress, angiotensin, endothelin, anemia, and fluid overload. The mechanisms with which increased cardiovascular mortality occurs in patients with end-stage renal disease include vasomotor dysfunction, increased arterial stiffness, elastin degeneration, left ventricular hypertrophy, and myocyte degeneration. Finally, there is increased coronary artery occlusion and calcification, myocardial fibrosis, calcification of the arterial media, and neo-intimal hyperplasia, which results in increased graft stenosis. That's it for our presentation on renal replacement therapy. Thanks for watching, and we will see you in the next video.